All right, tonight we have Jordan Maxwell from the JordanMaxwellShow.com. Mr. Maxwell has been bringing light to the world of darkness since 1959. He's a monumental researcher, an independent scholar that specializes in the field of occult and religious philosophy. How are you tonight, Mr. Maxwell?
Well, I think okay. We'll find out soon enough.
Yeah, it's been. I've heard that you had a bit of you were a little bit ill for a while.
Yeah, I had a heart attack about a year and a half ago or so, and but I've been very sick for a long time, since mid 1980s. I became very, very sick and had an emotional nervous breakdown and lost everything, and then I ended up having a heart attack. So. But I'm still here,
and that
somehow or another,
you.
I'm still alive and still doing the work I've been doing for almost 60 years now. I've been talking to audiences for 56 years about the world we live in.
it's impressive.
I guess I'm still here doing it.
Yeah, and especially to be facing illness, you know, for a major period of your life.
It's true.
Determination. You've got a calling to do it. So
I feel that anyway.
Well, it's admirable that you stick by it. So Jordan, right now, I mean, we've experienced something that was pretty divisive in the nation as far as mind you, like we just seen an election where it kind of set two sides against each other even more so than we've ever seen, right? And and I have this theory that both sides feel like that they are underdogs, right? They've always had this underdog mentality. Whenever one is in power, then the other one feels like they've got to fight for their team and they've got to really rally behind it. And we've never seen it to this point as far as marching the day of the day after the inauguration, and so I think it's really coming to a fountainhead or a real cross in our time period. And I kind of want to know what your thoughts are on the political environment right now. And
well, in relation to the Democratic Party. Mm-hmm. The word underdog seems to be a good term with the emphasis on dog. because the Democratic Party, most people do not know really anything about the United States Democratic Party. And so that's a whole subject that really needs to be investigated and exposed better to the people of this country. Because today, what we call the Democratic Party, I've only been looking at this subject for some 56 years.
Right.
And I always try and say at the beginning of any interview, which I've done over 600, but I always try and say that I'm not the world's foremost authority on anything. Mm-hmm. I'm just an ordinary man that's fascinated with extraordinary knowledge. And I've always been interested, even when I was a little kid, I've always been interested in the rest of the story, the whole story, not the story we've been given to believe, but what's the rest of the story. And so the rest of the story, when it comes to the Democratic Party, it's extraordinary, dark stuff that people are not aware of. The chief librarian for the Library of Congress is a man, James Billington. You don't get any more mainstream and a more powerful position than being appointed as the chief librarian for the Library of Congress.
Right.
And his name is James Billington. Well, he wrote a book, I don't know, maybe 20 years ago, still an extraordinarily important book. It's called, and incidentally, it's on the web for free download. The book is called Fire in the Minds of Men by James Billington. And in this book, Mr. Billington explains the revolutionary faith that has been going on throughout the world for hundreds of years. The dark, sinister, evil, occult forces of wars and violence and revolutions, and all of the occult religions of the world. The really background to all of this dark stuff going on in politics and religion throughout the world. And the book is called Fire in the Minds of Men, James Billington. And in that book, it's not the only one. There have been many other good reference books on this basic subject, but I just prefer his because it's so well written, filled with one third, and it's a very thick book, very thick. Mm-hmm. One third of that book is footnotes. Giving documents and footnotes on his work. It's just one third of the book is footnotes, in which he explains that what we today refer to as the Democratic Party is actually what has been known in the past as the Soviet Communist Society, Marxist-Leninism. Marxist-Leninist Soviet Communism is today in America, we call it the Democratic Party. Why? Because all of the communist countries during the 40s and 50s and 60s in our history, all of the communist countries were referred to as democratic republics.
That makes sense.
The People's Democratic Republic of China, mm-hmm. the People's Democratic Republic of Cuba, the People's Democratic Republic of North Korea. Everywhere you turn where there were communist governments, they were always referred to as People's Democratic Republic. And so democratic now carries the basic concept of a Marxist-Leninist Soviet Communist overthrow of Western civilization.
Right.
So this is just history. I'm just telling you what the history of mm-hmm. the Democratic Party is. Now, when you look at the Democratic Party and its connections to Marxist-Leninism and to the whole Soviet communist apparatus that was around the world in the 30s and 40s, and especially in the 50s, you begin also to see that in America, during those same years, 30s and 40s, in America, Chicago was a crime center for organized crime in America. Today, of course, we know it's New York is the center for organized crime of the world. New York is filled with organized crime. Mm-hmm. From murder, violence, drug addiction, killings. It's the organized crime of the earth is in New York. And that has something to do with the York of England and the Roman system of government in Britannia. When Rome moved into Britannia during the Middle Ages, the Roman government set up in England to run England was in the city of York, England. So, and I've been to York, England. There are statues all around York, England of Caesar and Roman statues. And so when that Roman organized crime syndicate, we call the Roman religion and the Roman government, the Roman Empire, when it decided that there was new business around the world and they came to what we call the New World, which is America, and we have now something called New York, mm-hmm. Based on the old York Rite of in England, based on the old established order of criminality overseen by the Roman Empire in Britannia, in the city of York. So right off the bat, you've got organized crime all the way through history, from the Roman Empire down till today. And so, as I said, the book Fire in the Minds of Men brings out that that we call what we call democracy is actually Marxist-Leninist Soviet communism. And so while we think the Soviet Union collapsed, no, it didn't collapse. It didn't fall. What happened was it mutated, just like a big corporations and businesses do. They have a tendency sometimes when they've been around too long and people don't like them anymore, and people are beginning to see that there's too much corruption in a great corporation or a big business. The big business and corporations they won't go out of business. They will merely mutate. They will change their name and move to a different section of town and put up a whole new facade, a whole new persona. And people think, well, oh, it's a new company. Yeah, we'll go there. Never realize, no, it's the same company. It's just that, you know, what they used to be, you don't like, so therefore they get rid of it, and now they're a different company. It's the same people doing the same thing. So what I'm saying is that the Democratic Party itself was nothing more than Marxist-Leninist communism, period, end of sentence. But now take into consideration Chicago during the 30s and 40s, Al Capone's Chicago was a center for organized crime. It was called the syndicates or the outfit or whatever. But in Chicago was also the basis for the Democratic Party in the United States. So now you have the Democratic Party, which is Marxist communism, now very strong in Chicago, where you also have Al Capone and all the organized crime and the mafia, etc., organized crime. That's why the two today are still there in Chicago. Organized crime is still in Chicago, but of course it's like everything else, has mutated so that now organized crime is not centralized in Chicago, very heavily there, but it's always been there. But now it's also in New York and California and Los Angeles, etc. So the point I'm making is that when you begin to see this history of the United States in relation to, first of all, organized crime, Chicago, the Democratic Party, the Soviet communism, the Marxist-Leninist communism, then we begin to, for the first time, begin to see the connections. And it's very easy to do if you just go to a library and start doing some research on it. The connection between organized crime, mafia, etc., whatever the syndicates were back then in the 30s and 40s and 50s, there's a connection, a direct connection in Chicago between organized crime and the Democratic Party. We do know from history, from looking at the newspaper articles and magazine articles and the news reports coming out of Chicago in the 30s and 40s and 50s, that there was a direct connection with the Democratic Party and organized crime. And the Democratic Party would pay organized criminal figures for assassinations, for corruption, for forcing people to vote a particular way. So the Democratic Party has got a rich history of connection to organized crime, Chicago, which is exactly where Obama came from.
Yeah, okay. I got it. So what do you make of Trump?
I like Trump as a man. I am apolitical. I don't vote for anything. I haven't ever voted for anything in my life. Mm-hmm. And the reason why is because even as a kid, I felt, I didn't intellectually understand, but I felt I don't want to be a part of anything. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be a part of any organized movements, political movements, or anything. I just want to be who I am and understand everybody and understand what's going on. I don't care to be a part of on one side. I want to know the whole picture.
I like that.
So I've never really voted for anybody. I don't intend to vote for anybody. I am what we might call apolitical.
Fantastic. So.
But I was going to say, okay, my personal feelings about Trump is that, first of all, I like him as a man to start with. Mm-hmm. I admired him as a man to start with. And as a president, he's the only president, and this is just a subjective opinion. I'm just giving you my view, my opinion,
yes,
for whatever that's worth. I was very impressed with him when he was started to run for president. And the reason why I particularly like him is because in my lifetime, I'm 76 years old, but in my lifetime, he's the only president that I can think of that actually had a damn job to start with. He actually had a job and a company, and he made money, and he actually did something with his life, mm-hmm, before he became president. All the other presidents are sucking on the tit of America to suck up the money, do business with the mob, meet in their smoke-filled rooms in the Waldorf Astoria and in their hotel rooms in Chicago, New York, Detroit. Our political leaders are nothing more than organized criminals meeting with organized crime. The whole dirty system is an organized criminal syndicate, except in particular the Democratic Party leads the way, because right, their history of organized criminality in Chicago with the mafia and with, mm-hmm, Capone's operation is legendary. So anyone who knows about the organized criminality in America knows the Democratic Party is part of it.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that being the case, the point I wanted to really make was that I think Trump at least has shown something that nobody else has ever been able to do as a president, mm-hmm, has shown that he actually had a job. He actually had a company, and he's actually running a company, and he's damn well successful at it.
So
that tells me that at least he's run corporations and companies and knows something about business, mm-hmm, which as far as I'm concerned, I've only been around for 76 years. But as far as I'm concerned, all the other presidents that have ever been in my lifetime I've seen, all of them come from rich, wealthy families that they themselves never did a damn thing, period.
Yeah.
They just went to all the elite colleges and universities. They never had a job. They never gave a job to anyone. They never paid for anything. So they were nothing more than just elitist, criminal elitist.
Yeah,
period. So, I don't care who they are.
I think that's kind of the general sentiment of most people. I mean, I think some people would say that he kind of also had a silver spoon, but I do think that he's championing the people. I think what got him to so much, I guess, gravitas or whatever to people is, like I said, there's the underdog mentality. And then also I think that that on the right, there has been a building for the last probably longer than 8 years, probably 16 years. Those people also felt like they didn't have a say. They felt that the brunt of the media, everybody condemning them for who they were, and thought that you know, thinking, oh, you know, the basket of deplorable comment and how the media just kind of looks down their nose at people. And so this guy, he kind of is able to sling mud back at them. And I think that was what was so attractive to the public. But I still have a hard time believing that he's truly an outsider. I don't believe that the establishment would have allowed him to become elected, if you will. I tend to say that he was selected. And I think if all of this that's going on and he continues to go down this path, if he is truly an outsider, I don't think he'll last. I think that it, just like we've seen in the past, whenever there was somebody that did start to maybe wake up to what was happening or thought that they were in too deep, and then, you know, we see JFK, right? He got gone. They shot Reagan whenever he started to buck the system a little bit, and then they either you play ball or you're dead. And I kind of think that that's what's going on still. But I do notice that out there in the public, I mean, a lot of people say the same thing. They say, well, you know, he's our champion because he's actually standing up to the elitist media and telling them that, you know, to go pound sand
I think he's sincere. I think he really is standing up to the powers that be. Of course, I understand that the system itself that the Western civilization lives under is already sewed up. The powers that be are the powers that be, and there's nothing going to change that. Mm-hmm. The international banking cartels are nothing more than secret societies and murderous organizations that kill, finance wars, finance revolutions. They finance the television, movies, and Hollywood. And so the whole entire dirty Western civilization system is a criminal empire.
Mm-hmm.
But having said that, I still think that Trump is, because he has been in the world of big business and obviously building hotels and casinos and golf courses and God knows what else all over not only America but all over the world, he obviously has had to do business with and take into consideration organized crime, organized criminal syndicates, because you don't build a hotel on the East Coast without the mafia. It's not done. You're going to do any big business that's going to make a lot of money on the East Coast, you're going to deal with the mob. Bet on it.
Yeah, right.
And so he has shown that he knows how to handle big business. He knows how to make a lot of money. And so he understands as a capitalist. I don't have anything against people who make a lot of money. I don't care one way or the other. But I think he understands as a businessman that what he's up against is a Marxist-Leninist Soviet communism, culture, the Marxian culture.
Okay.
A culture of thinking in America that is based on the old Soviet communist model. And so that's why today the Democrats are so enraged with Trump is because they have been born and raised under Soviet-style Marxist communism in America. And the universities, schools, and the human institutions that we develop as humans. If you go back and do some real deep homework on Marxist-Leninism, the Soviet Union, who financed it, where did it come from, what is Soviet communism, what is the Marxist-Leninist philosophy, once you do that kind of study, you are forced to understand then that's what America is today, a Marxist-Leninist Soviet communist operation on the world scene today. We are the new Soviet Union,
mm-hmm.
period. Now, given that as a fact, someone who is an American who is into making money and knows how to conduct himself in making big money and dealing with big money and building hotels and like I said, all that kind of thing is American capitalism. Of course, the Marxist-Leninist system that was perfected in the Soviet Union and now is brought into America, and we call it the Democratic Party. Obviously, the Democratic Party, being a communist society, is not going to be happy with an American who's into making money and being wealthy and making his own money and building hotels, etc. So their idea, the Democratic idea, is to promote the little person. And so we all are little people, and we're all just a little a blip on a computer screen in a bank. And nobody, according to the communist philosophy, according to the democratic philosophy, Nobody in America is worth a damn. Nobody. Mm-hmm. You're just a blip on a computer. Everybody knows that. The police department looks at people as just blips on the computer.
Right.
There's nothing individually important about you. There are no great intelligent people like the Nikola Teslas and Albert Einsteins and the great thinkers of the world that we've had in the past, the great philosophers. There is none of that under Marxist communism. You just all work for the government. The government will tell you what you can do and what you can't do. And so sit down and shut up and just be happy you're alive. So that's the American way today. Just go drink your beer and watch your silly ass ball games and bounce your ball and have your drinks and go out and party and watch your movies and just stay out of the way. We just entertain you because we're getting ready to sell you. So it's called Marxist-Leninist Soviet Communism or the Democratic Party. So like I said, I'm not the world's foremost authority on anything, but I've been looking at this stuff for 56 years. I know what I'm talking about. So and that's why Trump is getting so much opposition from the Democratic Party, People's Democratic Republic.
So what do you think the future holds for him and for the nation? I mean, do things get better? Does it come to a boiling point and it breaks out into race wars and riots, because there's a huge trend in the United States right now, and I think it goes just in line with what you're talking about as far as Marxism and its compartmentalization and the fragmentation of people of classes. I mean, if we look back at how the Soviet Union was formed, we had a class warfare. Well, now we have it even on a greater scale now that we have the gay and lesbian agenda. We have the Christian right. We have this. We have that. And we have all these different compartmentalized fragmentation of the population.
Divide and conquer.
And it has been divided. And now the last step is to be conquered. And I'm wondering, is that what's about to happen, or are we going to have an enlightenment? What's about to happen?
I think it's already happened.
Okay.
And so it's what I see happening and my interpretation of what's happening. And again, it's just my subjective opinion. I'm not an authority.
Well, that's why we have you on
just
here.
I'm an old man. I've been around for 76 years, and I've seen all this a long time before you were born.
Sure.
I was talking about all this stuff back in 1960.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're talking about a long time ago, 3 years before John Kennedy was assassinated. I was giving lectures in Los Angeles on secret societies, occultism, secret symbols and emblems, and all the dirty stuff going on behind banks and governments and religion. So I've been doing it for a long time. I've been watching this stuff evolve and mutate, for over 70, like I said, over 65 years. So while I'm not an authority on anything, I've been watching this stuff for a long time. And I'm telling you, there's no doubt in my mind that what is happening is that if you were to, say, for instance, happen to join an organization which you found out later was organized crime, you were in, unwittingly, you ended up in being an organized crime syndicate. And then you decide, because you found out now what you're really involved in is organized crime at its highest levels, then you decide that you want to clean up the organization. You're going to purposely put yourself on the line, put your family's life on the line, and you're going to expose this organization that you are working with and who they are and what they've done and do what you can to clean up this organization. Well, that on itself is ludicrous even to think about it, that you are going to change the entire organized criminal syndicate with yourself. You're going to go out and change it, and everyone's going to be happy and delighted that you cleaned up the organization. No, you most likely will be killed the first week. And so that's what's going on with Trump. He sees what is going on. He sees and understands what I do. He's not a fool. And so I know if I were, you know, if I were Trump, I wouldn't even consider doing what he's doing, because he's, you know, he's far more the man than I am. I just understand it and talk about it and you know, when I can. But he's actually doing something to clean up America. Well, my feeling is, boy, you got one hell of a job if you're going to clean up America. You're talking about organized criminal syndicates on the West Coast, mafia, and all of the different organized criminal syndicates mm-hmm. from all over the world, from the cartels in Central America, drug cartels, to the organized criminal syndicates in Italy and Germany, France, secret societies, fraternal orders, corruption, and everywhere is alcoholism and drug addiction and wire fraud and bank fraud. My God, you got a hell of a job if you think you're going to clean up the world now. So if you think you're going to clean up America and straighten this situation out, you better think again. This thing has been going way too long. It's far, far too gone. And so that's what I think. That's my opinion. But that's what I think is happening, is that we finally have a man who decides that he wants to do something to save the country. I think that's wonderful. That's a great idea, I mean, if it's possible. And maybe there's other wealthy people in the country who understand the Democratic Party, if left alone, is going to destroy everything that America has ever stood for: freedom, liberty, justice, honor, decency, individual responsibility and value. Everything that the United States of America has ever stood for, the Democratic Party are in direct opposition. Mm-hmm. They want this country destroyed.
So I
want to destroy the population. They want to destroy the culture. They want to destroy the background and foundations. They want this country destroyed. Why? Not because the Democrats want it destroyed, but who's financing them?
And that's what I want.
The real powers behind the Democratic Party are financing the Democratic Party, because they know the bankers who finance the Democratic Party view the Democratic Party as what they have called useful idiots. Mm-hmm. They are people who will go out into the street and put their lives on the line and burn and pillage and blow up tunnels and fires and revolutions in the street if you give them enough money. And so they're being paid to do this. So what we're seeing is the Democratic Party is nothing more than taking money under the table from organized crime to overthrow and to ultimately destroy the United States for what's left of it. I mean, we had a civil war, and that almost destroyed us completely. And now we're still having the same civil unrest again. Somebody outside of America wants this country destroyed. So they're putting up a lot of money and setting up a whole apparatus to ultimately destroy the United States of America.
Yeah, I would agree.
That there's no doubt in my mind.
I would agree. And I want to, Jordan, I have, in my opinion, I think that both parties are very culpable in the destruction of individual freedom and personal liberties and value. I do want to I wouldn't have you on here if I couldn't ask you these questions regarding like darker forces at be, like if Trump truly is wanting to try to clean up the United States of America and champion individual freedoms and personal liberties, but if we've kind of established that there's a criminal syndicate. Even more so, like even the deeper, I don't know if you've gotten into any of this stuff or even had any look at this stuff, but the blood sacrifices and all of the mysticism that's going on with John Podesta and that crew. And then if
I was talking about that stuff some 40 years ago.
What's going on? Does that go back to Saturnalia, to the worship of Saturn, or What's happening there? What's
It's a very, very big story. Yes, mm-hmm. all of that and that much more that you don't know. Okay. it may sound like I'm self-aggrandizing, but I have a video that mm-hmm. I started to make back in 1967, which is 56 years ago or something like that, 50 years ago. Anyway, back in 1967, I came across some information in California, and I was doing some research on Nazism, the whole Nazi philosophy, mm-hmm. and the Soviet communism and its philosophy, and where they, how the two were being financed, where they were getting their money from. And so I made some startling discoveries. Well, one of them in particular was I discovered that they were both Nazism and communism were being financed by the same people. And knowing that and understanding that, that brings into play now a third party. Because on the one side, you've got the right, and on the other, you have the left. And, you know, communism has always been referred to as left-wing communism, left-wing Democrat, right-wing Republican. Where do we get this idea of the left, right, left wing, right wing? It's because the eagle has always been a national symbol for almost all countries of the world. An eagle has played a very important part in the national symbolism. And in India, in Africa, in Asia, Russia, all over the world, going back as far back in history as you can find, ancient civilizations, ancient countries,
ancient Sumer even, right?
have always used the eagle. Mm-hmm. Mexico uses the eagle. America has the bald eagle. The Romans had the eagle. Greeks had the eagle. Babylonians, Sumerians, Egyptians, all had the eagle. And the reason why is because the eagle only has two wings, left wing and right wing. Mm-hmm. But there's a brain in between that controls both the left and the right wing, and that's how it flies. And so that's why our system in government in America is both left wing and right wing. It's a two-party system. There's no room for a third party. Mm-hmm. The whole entire governmental structure is based on occult and ancient symbolism. So once you understand that the eagle is important to all governments and all banks, all educational institutions, police departments, it's a symbol that's found all over the world. Why? Because it always, always represented the sun. And so the sun was very high up, and it was perfectly round, like your eye, and the pupil of your eye, perfectly round. And so the sun was always viewed by the ancient people as God's eye in the sky. And God's not in the dark. He's not ignorant and living in the dark. He's very bright. Well, so is the sun, very bright. And it's like it looks like an eye. That's what the Egyptians said. Called the eye of Horus, the eye of God. So my point being is that there's ancient symbolism going on in America and around the world that a handful of people at the top understand. We don't understand that this is an old story going back thousands of years. And the United States, Russia, China, and all the other great powers of the world have been around for thousands of years, and the people who run this planet have been aware of this occult or hidden system of government, hidden system of finance. This stuff is very, very old. None of this is new. You know, like the Bible says, nothing new under the sun, and boy, there isn't. But I can tell you for a fact that you don't know how the world works. And I've been saying this for years, that the people of America, like the people of the earth, the people of America have no, they have no power to do anything. In America, you can complain and cry and rant and rave about the conditions you live under, but you can't do anything about it. That's different from crying about it, but you can't do anything. Why can't you do something about it? Why can't the average person on the street do something? They can't do it because they have no power to do it. Why? Because knowledge is power. And if you have no knowledge of how the world works, then you are powerless. And this is exactly where we are today. The world of mankind is powerless to do anything because you just don't understand how the world works. You don't realize and understand how banks work. You don't know what a police department is. You don't know who owns your government. You have no idea in the world who prints your money. You don't know who sets up universities and colleges and auto agencies and finances governments around the world. You have no knowledge of any of that. So how are you going to work to do anything to better the world? You don't know how the world even works. So that's why I've been trying to say to people for many years, educate yourself as to how the world actually works. And I will guarantee you that you have no idea in the world the real story behind world governments, behind banking, money, behind educational institutions around the world. It's all part of one vast ancient system. And this is why I've been trying to tell people for many years. This is why when I see Donald Trump doing what he's doing, I know, I don't know if he does, but I know he's up against one hell of a mess. You want to take on the organized crime in America? You want to try it? I'm not talking about just New York. I'm not talking about just Detroit or Chicago or L.A. or San Francisco. I'm talking about taking on the entire dirty underworld operation going on around the world. You want to try it? Give it a try and watch what's going to happen to you.
Right.
So if you think you're going to come in and clean up America, you better think again.
So
the American people love what's going on. They love the situation that they're in today. And the reason why is because they go along with it. Oh, of course, they cry about it and bellyache about it, but they're not going to do anything about it.
Right, because they're comfortable and they're complacent. But so since we have the right and the left battling each other, and you stated that there's the brain, the bird's head, right, that runs the whole thing, the whole show. So whenever Trump's the champion of the people, who's he really fighting against then? I mean, if that's the case, then who really runs the show? Who is that eagle's head? What is that? Who is that?
I'm glad you brought that up.
Anunnaki? Is it reptilians? What do we got going on? Is it just global bankers, just sick people that just run the entire world, and they're just trying to make money off of war and harvesting of organs and child trafficking and all these evil monstrous deeds that are committed?
Yeah, but they don't look at it as evil. Mm-hmm.
Right.
It's just business. Like the mafia says, hey, we like you. You're a nice guy, but I've been set to kill you. Mm-hmm. And so I don't care. I mean, I personally like you, but it's just business.
Mm-hmm.
So I got to do what I got to do.
That's all it is then. It's these global banksters that are making tons of money off of destabilization of the Middle East, keeping the left and the right twisted up in a battle of if it's okay to have transgender bathrooms in Target and all of these just absolutely ridiculous things that we get so consumed with and forget about our daily lives. So that's what it is. And the only way to really take back the power is to identify who those monsters are at the top.
Now, I'm glad you brought that up. Because I'm not self-serving. However, it does serve me to tell you that I have a new video that I've been working on since 1967.
Okay.
And that's a long time ago. I've been working on this one subject of who are these people in the background, who are they? Because obviously this world that we live in, as corrupt and as criminal as it is at every point, but it still works.
Mm-hmm.
And people still go to work. They still take the vacation. They still drive nice cars. People buy homes. Life goes on, even though it is all criminality. And so I started looking into that subject of who is behind the world criminality. How does this stuff work? It must have some sort of a central location where some kind of a melting point where all the information of around world government, world commerce, somebody is orchestrating all of this. Well, in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul wrote in the New Testament story in the Bible, I think it's in the book of Ephesians, where it's a very famous scripture. I know you've heard it. Everybody else has. But the Apostle Paul said, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, and world rulers of this darkness.
Right. And who
and
is that?
I thought, now, that's an interesting statement in the Bible, that mm-hmm. we wrestle against the world rulers of darkness, meaning yeah. that the world is in dark. It's in violence and chaos. It's, you know, suicides, drug addiction, alcoholism, all kinds of self-destructive behavior of the human race. A lot of people are dying out of suicide. Why? Because the world is in the dark. We don't know how nothing works. All we know is it's killing us. Mm-hmm. And so the scripture says that there are rulers of world darkness, which implies somebody is in charge of the mess that we're in on the earth. Somebody is ruling the darkness. So who are these people who are ruling the darkness that we live in? I have been looking at that subject for, as I said, since 1967. I have put together a video called, and this dealing with that subject of the world rulers. I call it Cosmocrators. The word is Cosmocrators, but a shortened form of that word, which is the name of my video, is Cosmocrats, because cosmos means world. The whole world is cosmos, right. Like cosmonauts. Mm-hmm. All right. So cosmos means world, and krats implies rulers, like democrats,
right.
plutocrats. And so krats means ruler, and cosmos means world. So I have entitled my video, World Rulers, or Cosmocrats. And who are these cosmocrats that are hidden behind the veil of time, that are hidden behind the world scene, that are running our planet and pouring on us all of this violence and stupidity and ignorance and religion and alcohol and drug addiction and wars, etc. Somebody's in charge of this earth that are destroying the people and the nations. And so I've been doing a lot of research on this for 56 years. I have put out a video now called Cosmocrats,
okay,
in which I am showing you, documented, how the world actually works and who these people are at the very top you've never heard of before, mm-hmm. and who they are, where they are, and all the documents, and from all over the world, documentation on the secret world of cosmocrats, people who run this planet.
Run the planet.
So it's on my website, and my website, because there are other websites out there with my name on it. A lot of people out there making money off of my name, but my website is Jordan Maxwell Show, S-H-O-W. So if you want to avail yourself of my work, it's jordanmaxwellshow.com. When you go to jordanmaxwellshow.com, you will see two things that I've added which are new and I want you to know about. One, at jordanmaxwellshow.com, you will see on the right-hand side of the homepage an advertisement of two videos that I have now put out there finally. I finally got, after 56 years, I'm finally able to put it together and make a video. It's not an MGM musical. It's not a Universal blockbuster. It's just the best I could do with nothing. But at least the information is important. And so I have a new video called Cosmocrats. And with it, I have a second video I put out at the same time on one of the biggest secrets about religion in the Western world that people have no knowledge about at all. But when you talk about religion in the Western world, in the Christian, Judeo-Christian world, there are secrets about Judeo-Christianity that you've never heard before.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have put together two new videos, the secrets behind Western world religion, and second, the secrets behind the people who run the planet, the cosmocrats. And so that's what we were talking about. Well, that's what my new videos are about.
Fantastic.
Now, also, along with the two new videos that I have on my website, you will also see a little banner at the top that says Research Society. So go to JordanMaxwellShow.com and you will see Research Society. What that is a new email, is a new website that I have put together on which I'm uploading all of my research over the years, from audio, video, articles, pictures, diagrams, links and people of real and valuable importance, people who are very legitimately intelligent people who have done some magnificent research work on what's going on in the world. I want to make sure you know about these people and who they are and why they're so important. So I've got a whole section just on important people you need to know about. And here's where you find them. Here's what they're doing. Here's what they're talking about. And also articles. I've got articles on that research website that, you know, could possibly get me in trouble. But right. I discovered, my lawyer friends have told me, that if you're going to say something in public that might get you in trouble, then don't do it. What you need to do is, if you're going to do something to expose something, do it privately. Do it private, not public. Because, let me give you an example. Mm-hmm. If you and about 10 of your friends all go to a restaurant one night, and you're sitting around the back of the restaurant talking, that's a private conversation. Nobody in there has any business hearing what you're talking about. And at that table, you can use any language you want that you think your friends will accept. You can use any language you want, any cursing you want, call anybody anything you want, because it's a private conversation. Maybe your friends don't like it. Maybe they agree. Doesn't matter. The point is, you can say anything you want that you think you can get away with your friends, but nobody can say anything to you. Why? Because it's a private conversation. Now, if you go out into the public on radio and now start talking the way you did it in the restaurant, that's different. Now, when you're cursing and calling people names with that kind of language, mm-hmm. now the government can come in and do something about it.
Yeah.
It's no longer private. You are now on radio talking like that in public. So the idea is that government is empowered to protect the people. And so to protect the people from your mouth and from what you're saying and all all the stuff you're saying, the government has to protect the people. So they'll pull you off and you can be arrested. You can go to jail for talking and calling mm-hmm. people names in public. And so that's why I was told by my attorney friends to, if you're going to do something that might put you in trouble or get you in trouble with some organization or government, then do it privately. Do it in private.
Sure
and
thing.
So that's what I have done. I have got a second website now mm-hmm. that in which I am uploading all kinds of private research, private documents, words and terms and people and symbols and emblems, audio, video, all kinds of strange stuff, really, really powerful stuff, but in private. I don't want the world seeing it because I don't want the trouble that comes with it.
Right.
Now, of course, if somebody takes what I've got in that private and copies it and puts it out into the public and there's trouble because of it, Government can't come to me. I did it in private. This was a private conversation.
And that's
if you don't like it, go get the guy who put it out in the public, not me.
And that's at Jordan Maxwell Research Society, right? So that's Jordan Maxwell Show.
Jordan Maxwell Research Society. Now, incidentally, one other thing with that is that you have to join it to be a part of my private organization. And it's only a one-time $30 payment, one-time donation for $30 for a lifetime subscription to all of my work. I've been doing this for 56 years. Slowly but surely, I'm putting everything on that research website. So I have to pay to keep the website up on the web. I have to pay the webmaster. I've got to pay all kinds of other bills and costs to keep it going.
Sure thing.
I only charge one price, one time, $30 for a lifetime donation for $30 of a lifetime subscription to all of my work. Mm-hmm. And I've been doing it for many years. So if you go on to Jordan Maxwell Show, I have a research website you can join, and also two videos which are very pertinent to the stuff that's going on today. And I want to thank you for letting me have a few minutes to talk about my
work. No problem. I got one more question for you, and then we'll get out of here. So my next question is, when's the next time you're going to come on?
My answer is no. When's the next time I'm going to come on? I'm asking you.
Well, we'll
anytime
what we'll
you
do is
want me on, I'm here. You've got my email, and all you got to do is let me know, and I'm here.
And what I'll do next time, and this kind of was an introductory to our listeners. We've had you on before, but it's been probably 2 years, and so this is kind of, we've got a lot of new listeners now, and we're doing YouTube and stuff, and so this is kind of an introductory. And so next time, what I'll do is I'll get a more refined questions. And
that's
get you,
okay.
And
get, that's all right. It's always fun. I'm always happy to talk with you.
And
we can always talk about anything because there's so many subjects out there that people know nothing about. And and I enjoy talking to the world about my work.
Yeah, and
I've been doing this kind of reading and studying and research for many, many years, and people have no idea in the world what the world you live in really is like and what it really is doing.
I think the first time that I listened to you, what really fascinated me was the how you have the breaking down of I think you gave an analogy of if you live on the second floor and how we come about an understanding, how you had to get underneath and stand underneath the floor and look up to see what you're standing on, and kind of give you the foundation understanding and just the breakdown of words. And I think the next time we have you on, I think what we'll do is we'll run down just a bunch of definitions and try to clear stuff up for people. Let them get those definitions and kind of make their own determination of what's going on in the world as well. So, Jordan, it's been a pleasure. JordanMaxwellShow.com. And then you go over there and sign up, folks. Throw them your $30. Get the Research Society website. And
you will find it's filled with all kinds of esoteric and occult knowledge and people and places and articles and audio and video and strange knowledge about all kinds of hidden subjects that people don't know anything about. That's my whole life, is looking at the occult world that's hidden from the people. People don't know what's going on, and that's why they have no power, because knowledge is power. So that's I have got on my website. Again, it's JordanMaxwellShow.com.
All right. Thank you, sir. I appreciate it. Have a great
night. Thank you.
And we'll talk to you again soon. I'll email you and let you know.
Okay. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
All right, folks. I want to thanks again to Jordan Maxwell. I know we only got into just a little bit of it. We didn't get into the esoteric and the deeper, darker speakings about who's really running the world. I do have my thoughts on that. And Nick's not here tonight, but he's got his thoughts. And I want to plug our show. You can get us at spearheadtransmission.libsyn.com. That's for just the audio. And this likely won't be released until maybe we'll probably do some. This is going to be some hidden stuff, right? Please like and show please like and share us on Facebook. That really helps us out. And make sure to hit the subscribe button. And once you do subscribe, click that bell so that you can get notifications. That also helps us out to the channel. And other than that, we're gonna keep Tuesday night. I think we have a pretty big show. That then we have three guests. We'll hope they all show up. It'll be definitely a good show. I don't wanna say any names yet because there's three topics that that are pretty hot on this show. So anyways, thank you. Subscribe. And that's all. Adios, muchachos.